This is Deus Ex. It's a classic from 2000 and is considered one of the greatest conspiracy theory simulators of all time. And yet, it has nothing compared to the video game franchise we're going to be talking about today.
Perception of reality is as important as reality itself. You control perception.
You control events. GBS controls perception.
Strike controls reality. At least that's the way it's supposed to work.
Hello everyone, Ace here, and today let's talk about what I believe to be the greatest conspiracy theory simulator franchise ever created. A franchise that, while massively popular back in the day, and also having a massive influence on the industry that can be felt to this very day, and despite all of that, is still nevertheless extremely obscure these days. Today, let's talk about the Strike franchise, and why it is, in my opinion, the greatest conspiracy theory simulator franchise ever created. To start off from the very beginning, the Strike franchise first saw light all the way back in 1992, following the success of the then recent Operation Desert Storm. The very first game, Desert Strike Return to the Gulf, not only became a massive commercial success, but still holds a place as being amongst the very best games ever created for the Sega Genesis. The game itself revolving around flying a helicopter over a large sandbox-style map with the goal of accomplishing various objectives while making the very most out of your limited supply of fuel and ammo. Desert Strike and the Strike franchise in general had a massive impact on the industry because they were the progenitors of what we today consider to be the sandbox genre, with the Grand Theft Auto franchise taking heavy inspiration from the Strike games. A fact that is driven all the more home when you consider that later Strike entries task the player with commandeering various vehicles in order to complete their various objectives. It is also, however, worth mentioning that the Strike franchise was very controversial right from the very beginning, despite being set in a country that isn't even specified and against an evil dictator that isn't even specified. The fact that the game released so soon after Operation Desert Storm resulted in a fair amount of outrage, with game journalists accusing the game of being jingoistic as well as xenophobic for daring to depict a war in the Middle East, and there were even instances of copies of the game being burnt. And yes, for the record, even back in the 90s, there were examples of game journalists calling the games xenophobic, an accusation that is quite frankly unjustified. The next entry in the series was, of course, Jungle Strike from 1993, which introduced the ability to swap vehicles mid-mission. It's another great game in its own right, and has won numerous accolades as a result, but I'm going to have to circle back to this game a little bit later. For you see, it is with the third entry of the series, namely Urban Strike, where the franchise really begins to earn the reputation of being a conspiracy theory simulator, due to having one of the most eerily accurate predictions of the future ever told within a video game. To start off, Urban Strike from 1994 takes place in the then futuristic year of 2001, and tasks the player with fighting terrorists in various different missions. The one most notable for today's video happens to be the mission that takes place in New York City, which sees the World Trade Center become subject to terrorist attack. It is of note for the record that in the official Urban Strike We Come in Peace Shoot to Kill comic series, the terrorists responsible for the attack on New York City are described as, quote, kamikaze ninjas. In other words, individuals who will use stealth in order to put themselves into positions where they can launch kamikaze-style attacks. But wait, there's more. Because if you are the sort of individual who believes that 7-Eleven was a part-time job, then you may be interested to hear that the main antagonist of Urban Strike happens to, in the lore, run for president in the previous year, and it also turns out that the bad guys packed the Twin Towers with explosives that you have to then disarm in order to save the Twin Towers. In other words, not content with predicting 9-11, and even the year in which 9-11 happens, the game even managed to also predict the conspiracy theories surrounding 9/11. You may be beginning to see why I've decided to call the Strike franchise the greatest conspiracy theory simulator ever made, considering the sheer accuracy of this particular prediction. But it is only one prediction, I hear you say. And Deus Ex, by contrast, made multiple predictions about the future that ended up being more accurate than not. Well, yes, if the Strike franchise did end with Urban Strike, that would genuinely be the case. But now I get to talk about Soviet Strike. And strap yourselves in, because this is where the rabbit hole really starts to go deep. For start, I should mention that with Soviet Strike, the franchise saw something of a soft reboot, with the lore from the earlier games retained, but the function of Strike as an organization being greatly expanded upon. With Soviet Strike, it's revealed that Strike is not just a highly skilled elite military organization that occasionally delves into the subject of espionage. Instead, Strike is depicted as an organization outright above the law. And not only that, but outright reduces people such as the President of the United States to mere puppets who hold little real power and can easily be replaced by Strike if it should be deemed as necessary. For those curious, just listen to the game's audio for yourself.
Here's how it's going to work, Mr. President. We let you worry about the domestic agenda, all the touchy-feely stuff. But when it comes to national security, Strike makes all the hard decisions. Do you remember the Civil War of 82, which turned Mexico into a Warsaw Pact client state?
Well, I don't know what you're talking about. There never was any Mexican Civil War.
That's the point. There would have been if Strike hadn't interceded. You see, sir, we measure our success by the wars that never happened. Get my drift?
But I thought I was in charge. Your organization undermines the chief executive.
Sir, I'm here to explain how things work. If you don't want to play ball, I'm sure the vice president will. We've had to deal with that very unpleasant situation before.
Sir, what do you suppose the president is going to say when he finds out we've got a convict running the most highly secured net in the world?
Who cares?
Sir, would you care to comment about reports of your involvement with an illegal renegade operation known as Strike?
I can neither confirm nor deny the existence of such an organization.
Is it true that your organization routinely violates enemy sovereignty, carries out black bag operations and covers them up, all with no regard for the will of Congress, the President, or the American people?
No comment.
Sir, is it also true that your motto is, quote, we measure our success by wars that don't happen?
I don't see what you're driving at, Ms. Gray.
I want to work with you. I'd be perfect. You've already got the weapons, you've already got the intel. What you need is the third leg of the power triad, the media. I'm here to give it to you.
So yes, Strike is all too capable and willing to replace an unruly president should they feel the desire to do so. And keep in mind that even in the old lore, Strike Corps was known for carrying out the occasional assassination of someone they didn't like, meaning that the replacement process of the president with the vice president might not necessarily be that peaceful. In other words, in the world of Soviet Strike, the deep state exists and is not above killing off US presidents. Presidents, should it feel the need to do so. And this is far from the only example of just how much power Strike has, as they also control the media as well, with one of the key agents of Strike being Agent Andrea, a spy who poses as a news reporter, and whose job is not only to provide boots on the ground intelligence, but also to control the narrative, often passing off entire battles as just being an earthquake bro.
A freak forest fire has swept across a wide section of Crimea early this morning. The flames spread quickly to a local airport and even engulfed a resort villa. Eyewitnesses report seeing pillars of smoke from miles away. Though details are not clear at this time, it appears this disaster was caused by an abandoned campfire.
Speaking of which, allow me to then move on to some of the missions that you will find within Soviet Strike, with three of the different missions taking place in Crimea, the Black Sea, and around Chernobyl, all three of which are located apparently within southern Russia. The game also tasks you with battling the forces of the evil warlord Dr. Gremyenko Ukrainian, who is a mad scientist from Russia. And I should also mention that the main antagonist of Soviet Strike just so happens to be a former member of the KGB. And would you like to guess which current global leader happens to be a member of the KGB? So yes, Soviet Strike managed to predict the war in Ukraine, as well as the rise of Vladimir Putin. But wait, there's more. For you see, there's also one additional mission that takes place in the fictional country of Iraq, spelled I-R-E-K, which the player invades in order to stop the Iraqi leader from obtaining weapons of mass destruction. So yes, the game also managed to predict the war in Iraq, because of course it did. In fact, considering that Desert Strike also exists and also predicted a war in the Middle East, that means you can chalk up the prediction that the games were able to predict two separate wars in the Middle East. And considering how many of these predictions from Soviet Strike have been more recent events, one now has to wonder if the events from Jungle Strike or Nuclear Strike, the two remaining games in the franchise, will also end up panning out. Both have some, let's be honest, spooky potential. For example, in the case of Jungle Strike, it's worth noting that Washington DC becomes a battlefield. So yeah, if that ends up becoming an accurate prediction, then that's not exactly a good sign. It's with regards to Nuclear Strike, however, that it becomes a little bit more worrying. Partially because Nuclear Strike revolves around the plot of North Korea becoming a nuclear power, something that the game has already predicted. The game also already predicted the fact that a US president would go visit North Korea to engage in peace talks. At this point, I want these games to actively stop predicting the future. As much of a fan as I am of the Strike franchise, I'm not exactly keen on living out the lore of the Strike franchise. But considering the fact that these games are about as accurate on predictions as The Simpsons, I believe I've made my point on why exactly these are the greatest conspiracy theory simulators of all time. They are a blast to play, and I highly recommend each and every single one of them. Unfortunately though, and quite curiously, it is of note that most of these games haven't really been getting the proper remaster treatment, despite being immensely popular back in the day and being amongst the very best games of the 5th and 6th generation. It's a franchise that absolutely deserves to be far better remembered than it is, and not just for the conspiracy theory angle, although let's be honest, that is becoming a far, far more interesting side of things the more time passes by. But in any case, this has been Ace. Hope to see you guys again soon. Take care. Ace out.